We're doing a show! Hey. I call this show The Beast of Taylor Mac. B-E-A-S-T. At least I wanted to call it The Beast of Taylor Mac. And I sent Beast to my marketing people, but they did not understand that. They thought it was a typo, so they took the A out, and now I have been hindered with high expectation. But I will muddle through. I live in New York City, as I was saying, where I do most of my work. I call them plays. This, what you're seeing right now before your very eyes, this is a play. Other people who are much smarter than me, they call them performance art pieces, which is really just a fancy way of saying drag. But I call them plays, and when I do my plays, what I will normally do is I'll take one topic to talk about. It'll have something to do with a current event, something like the war on terror, right? You take it apart, you put it back together again, you present it to the people, and you call it a play. But this being my second time performing in Portland, actually it's my 30th time performing, at least my 30th time performing in a Christian Science church. It's true. I'll let you ponder that. But this being my second time performing in Portland, I still want to introduce myself to the people of Portland, so I've decided to do a bunch of different numbers from a bunch of different shows. So what I've done is I've taken a bunch of different numbers, I've squished them together, we're presenting to the people, we're calling it The Beast of Taylor Mac. It's kind of like a Subversives jukebox musical. You've heard of Mamma Mia? That's a jukebox musical for the mainstream audiences. This is for the Subversives. People say to me, don't you ever get tired of preaching to the converted, you know? Rah, rah. No, the converted need inspiration, you know? Everyone says, support the troops, support the troops. You are my troops. I am supporting you, you know? I think of myself as the Bob Hope of drag. Well, I don't have a problem with that. But, also, when I do my plays, what I will normally do is I'll wear just one outfit. It'll have to do with the topic that I'm talking about, right? It's supposed to look kind of like that topic, right? So this was the outfit that I made for a show I did about the war on terror. It's conceptual. And the other thing that I do when I do my plays is I set up a rule. I don't like to start things off with a rule, but I have found that I have to. You guys here in Portland, you're very respectful of people, but, you know, you should see them in some places. You know, Abilene, they get a little crazy there. So I've had to set up a rule. The rule has to do with, first off, I don't like comparison. I think that comparison is violence. Comparison is violence. I give that to you. It's a gift. Comparison is violence. Comparisons are for people who don't have enough adjectives in their vocabulary. So I don't like to compare, but ever so often, I will point out the difference. So, let's say, instead of seeing this play tonight, you were seeing a much more traditional play. Right? Let's say you were going to London, to the West End, you were going to see Daniel Radcliffe in Equus. Now, you all know Daniel Radcliffe is the little boy who plays Harry Potter in all the movies, right? And when I was in London, he was starring in Equus in the West End. It's a story of a naked adolescent who stabs horses in the eyes. Not too different from the play that I'm about to perform for you tonight. But there are a few differences. And one of those differences are that when you go see Daniel Radcliffe in Equus, what do? You show up 10 minutes early, right? You turn off your cell phone, you sit down in your seats, you look through your program and everything, you talk, lights go down, and you get quiet, right? You get ready to receive what Mr. Radcliffe has to give you. And maybe when he gets naked, you get a little giggly. You're, oh! Goblet of fire! Woo! The chamber of secrets! There are 7 jokes for each book. Everyone's in the audience now going, okay. So that's what happens when you go see Daniel Radcliffe, and then people in front of you or behind you, they shush you and you say, oh, sorry. And why do you say sorry? Because you want to give respect to Mr. Radcliffe and his panicula. And why was this show with this adolescent sold out months and months and months in advance? Why was there a line all the way down the street hoping to get that one ticket that somebody doesn't show up? Oh, that poor fool that couldn't go. They, you know, they had a heart attack and they had to miss the show. Why? Because you want to see highbrow penis. Why? Because highbrow penis is guilt-free penis. If they called it the Hoochie Coochie Club, you might go, but you feel a little guilty, right? So they call it Equus, and you're like, yes, highbrow penis! Anyways, that's what happens when you see Daniel Radcliffe and Equus. Now, not to compare, just to point out the difference, this is often what happens when people come see me. They say, ding, 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 show's about to start, and the entire audience collectively gets up and says, okay, time to get a couple more drinks. I have found, I've played this show in basements of large theatrical institutions all over the world, and I have found that in these basements, anywhere between 5% to 95% of my audiences are wasted out of their minds. I think it has something to do with the way that I look. So I've had to set up a rule. Maybe you're respectful because you're here in a church. Maybe that's why we're not in the basement, we're in the church. Right? So you didn't show up drunk, but we always showed up drunk to my church. Anyways, so that's what happened. Okay, so yes, Daniel Radcliffe, yes, that's what happens, right? They treat me differently and stuff, so I've had to set up a rule. The rule has to do with chatty catties, right? People who talk at the theater, right? Some people call them chatty catties, I call them chatty catties. Right? Ooh, the chatty catties. No, I love the chatty catties. I really do love the chatty catties. And the reason that I love the chatty catties is because my friend, Mother Flawless Sabrina. Mother Flawless Sabrina is 68 years old and she's been doing drag since the late 50s. She is fierce. If you go out at night in New York City, 3 o'clock in the morning, you will see Mother Flawless Sabrina dressed up in her finery. I call this my finery, and she's dressed up in hers, in her drag. She's dressed up in her finery. She's on a go-go platform, 3 o'clock in the morning, giving a demonstration on how to put her dentures in on the platform. She's fierce. She's on speed. No, she really is. But she's fierce. And one day, Mother Flawless Sabrina, walking down the street, right? She's dressed up in her finery. She's like, work, 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 work. And these two men, they saw her and they shot her. They shot her in the ass. It's a little funny. It's okay. No, she's lucky to be alive. She survived. She's lucky to be alive. She likes to say, I've got two holes in my ass. She likes to show you both of them, too. But I said to her, Mother Flawless Sabrina, those horrible, horrible, horrible people who did that to you. And she said, no, Taylor, not horrible. They just wanted to be part of the show. They just wanted to be part of the show. Now, I've had a few bottles thrown at me in my time, and I've had a lot of mean things said to me on the street when I was walking down the street dressed up in my finery, and I've even had a couple of guns pointed at me. But I've never actually been shot. And I figure if Mother Flawless Sabrina can get shot in the ass, and she can still give love to the perpetrators, I can handle a few chatty catties in the audience. Because the chatty catties, they just want to be part of the show. The thing of it is, this is a drag show. So, if you're going to get chatty catty, I'm going to put you in drag. Now, you may be saying to yourself, oh, but there's only one drag outfit up there, and it's on him. What's he gonna do, take it off him and put it on me? I just might. You too could be wearing the War on Terror. But you also may say, but it takes two people to get chatty catty. It takes two people, and there's only one drag outfit up there, right? So what's he gonna do? I'd like to take you back to the beginning of the evening when Barbara Walters brought on a suitcase. Chatty catties will get put in drag. Now, this nice couple right here, you know, let's say they're talking, right? They're like, talk, 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 talk. I think people who talk at the theater, it's ridiculous to talk at the theater, so they must be talking about something as ridiculous. So let's say they're talking about bowling, right? So they're like, he's like, bowling, 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 bowling. And she's like, bowling, 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 bowling. And I come over to them and I say, honey, I'm going to put you in drag. Now, this is what happens. I've seen this happen. The man, he takes the woman and he pushes her in front of him. Right? He thinks she will protect him. She won't protect you. Your friends, your neighbors, your loved ones, they will turn on you. They want to see you humiliated. Okay, chatty catties will get put in drag. Now, one final thing before we commence with the excitement. Are there any heterosexuals in the audience tonight? Okay, I have a feeling there are a few more of you than that. rest of you are just embarrassed. Don't worry about it. I love the heterosexuals. You know, I wouldn't be here if it weren't for the heterosexuals.
What?
No, I love the heterosexuals, and they come to my work all the time. And, you know, at first I was pleasantly surprised. I didn't understand why it was happening, but I thought, wow, I'm getting out of the ghetto, you know? It was fun. Oh, goddamn, the rainbow flags. Yeah, right? So I was happy. But then I realized why it was happening was because of the marketing. Because the marketing people, they like to say that this is a universal show. It's a universal show! Right? Because when you're a gay performer, or a black performer, or a minority performer, or even a female performer, they like to say, it's universal! Because they want people to come. They're doing you a favor. Because the worst thing that could possibly happen is that you would go to the theater to experience something new. So they say, it's universal! I write this material for gay people, and if you are gay in the audience tonight, perhaps you could get something out of it. And if you are heterosexual, perhaps you could just listen. It's not universal. In fact, if you are heterosexual, you won't understand a single thing that is said tonight. Okay! Now we're gonna open up Pandora's suitcase. We're gonna find out what's inside, okay? This is my Save the Dolphins dress. I don't know what that is. Oh, this is a good one. I got this in Edinburgh at the farmer's market. I got this at the farmer's market. And I said to the lady, I said, you know, Edinburgh's my kind of town, you know? And I said to the lady, wow, you know, I might wear it on stage. And she said, I don't know what to say to that. This is a dirndl. Dirndl. I put an aggressively heterosexual man in London in this room. He had a lot of fun. Okay, here's some shoes. That's shoes. I like to mix up the drag up a little bit. You know, a little football jersey. Okay, there we go. Oh, if you're gonna kill, if you're gonna save dolphins, you gotta kill squirrel, you know. Okay, there we go. Looks good. Okay, there we go. Yeah. Looks like at home, and I said, you know, well, while I'm on tour, at least I can have a clean room. Okay, there we go. I think that's it for now. Okay, so, I'm gonna change periodically throughout the course of the evening. This is a highbrow event! It's a highbrow event, so I'm gonna channel Proteus. Proteus. Proteus was a shapeshifter. He could turn himself into whatever he wanted to. So I'm using highbrow event, Proteus. If it were a lowbrow event, I'd be channeling Kylie Minogue. You can tell the gays on here on mass, because if I said that and it was an all-gay audience, they'd be like, ah, you can't make fun of Kylie, ah. You should have seen them in Sydney, you know, there I was out. It's Kylie, she's from Sydney, you know, and I was like, la, 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 la. And everyone in the audience was like, ha, 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 ha. And then I said that, and they all went. It's hardcore. It's hard. I'll win them back. Okay, so here we go. I'm going to change. Proteus, for those of you who don't know, Proteus was the son of Oceanus. Oceanus was an ocean god. Who knew, right? And Proteus was his son. He was a shapeshifter. He could turn himself into whatever he wanted to. Why? Because the polytheistics, they had fun gods with superpowers. We have a god who basically hates us. That's his superpower. No, the polytheistics, they had Zeus, who would turn himself into a shower of gold or a swan and make love to you, right? They were into bestiality and golden showers. Our god gets mad when we hold hands. We're muddling through. So I put this on backwards, because backwards is always better than forwards. And pieces of this dress will fall off. Pieces of my face will fall off periodically throughout the course of the early evening. 6:30. I've been in drag earlier than this, but, you know, I don't see it as a hindrance. I see it as like, ooh, I'm infiltrating the normal people time. Oh, hey, this is a got sensible shoes on now.
Okay, here we go. Oh, get that necklace out of the way.
All right. Women always say to me, how can you wear shoes like that? I could never wear shoes like that. And I always say, you know, well, for you it's oppression. For me it's liberation. All right. Paul, can we please have the special light that says I'm about to sing my next song?